Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the weekend edition, and thank you for joining us. As you can see, we've got a bunch of beautiful people joining us today. The lovely Theodora Lee is here. Yep. You're a blogger?
Yes, a YouTube vlogger.
You're a vlogger?
Yeah,
and what
vlogger.
And what do you vlog about?
I vlog about all sorts of things, but mainly it's lifestyle and advice videos for teenagers and young adults.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, so no bullying on your vlog?
Well, I talk about bullying, but I don't bully people, no.
Right. Yeah. And then an old friend, I guess. I didn't realize we actually met back in 2001.
Yes.
You were modeling, Ilse, Fourie.
Yeah.
So you were modeling and you were on the cover of Sports Illustrated?
Back then it was Sports Illustrated Swimwear. And so, I was on your
definitely
show.
Had
back
you on. Definitely had you on. And now you're going to be cooking for us. You're like a chef or a food consultant. What do you do?
Well, I did MasterChef 4 years ago. And then from there, it was cookbooks and cooking shows. And
wow.
I'm doing restaurant, like food consulting at the moment, menu design, etc.
That's incredible.
So, yeah.
Well, welcome to the Weekend Edition. Look
Thank
forward
you.
To Actually, we'll talk about what we're going to make today. I know you've got a special plan for us today. So Saturday, what's happening in the dining room, Khanyi?
Trust me, Joe, we'd like to know what you guys are cooking today. Welcome, South Africa. I'm sitting with three interesting people, Makho Ndlovu, Simphiwe Dana, and Chris Rogers. I'd like to welcome you guys.
Thank
so
you.
So you bully people.
I don't bully people. I believe in love and like creating a positive community.
She bullied me, though.
She bullied you?
Simphiwe bullied
morning,
me, she just called
already.
Me Ashy, so...
No, but that's a sister looking out for another
this
sister.
Is
that
true.
I don't
You gotta look out. No ashiness over here.
Yes.
No, definitely no bullying. It's all about love. I love celebrating women. I love African women. I'm passionate about them. And yeah, that's what I do.
Well, welcome to the show.
Thank
it's good
you.
To have you.
Thank you.
Sis Simphiwe, how are you doing?
I'm good, yeah. How are you?
Good, thank you. I love
tired.
The mohawk. I love the mohawk.
Thank you.
It's
thank
working.
You.
It's working. And Chris, welcome to the show. I know that you're going to hang out with us, giving us extreme experiences.
Going to try.
Yeah?
That should be fun.
So to help you wake up and to join us on the show, here's Simphiwe Dana giving you her first performance. Enjoy.
First song we're doing for you is called Zandisile from my first album titled The Same. This song I wrote for my daughter. So everyone always thinks that her name is Zandisile. No, her name is Zazi. But Zandisile means the one who fulfills her dreams. And that was my wish for her. Themba Mokoena on guitar. Yeah. jelly.
Fantastic. Guys, we got so much more coming up. If you like that, you're gonna love what we've got lined up for you. The Weekend Edition returns after this. It's a weekend. Guys, welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We're sitting here with blogger extraordinaire, actually award-winning, best award-winning blogger.
Wow. Thank you.
Theodora Lee, welcome to the Weekend Edition.
Thanks so much.
Yeah. Your brother is a blogger as well, a famous vlogger, Casper Lee.
Pretty world famous,
Is there any other vloggers in your family that we don't know about?
Well, family of vloggers.
I suppose my dad was a bit of a vlogger back in the day, but
there wasn't
YouTube back then, but he always had a camera on him. So I guess we were inspired by that,
Wow. What did he film?
He filmed us growing up.
Oh, wow, so you've got tons of video at home.
Yeah, we do.
So lucky.
I think that's probably why we progressed into it.
I got no video of me.
Oh, it's so nice watching.
Nothing.
Nothing. Yeah. Not a...
Birthday.
No, nothing. Pictures, lots of pictures, but no movie. Exactly. You shoot videos from your bedroom, right?
Yeah, sometimes.
Explain how you got into this vlogging thing and what you're trying to achieve.
Well, I study drama, and I've always loved film and media. Okay. I worked in TV once, actually.
Yeah.
So it did feel like a natural progression to pick up the camera again when I had more time after university.
Mm-hmm.
And I make YouTube videos that are inspired by my own life.
Okay.
But that also reflect on my own life and give advice to teenagers and young adults.
But you're not acting in it.
No, I'm not acting. I'm myself.
Yeah, is it like a diary where you have a conversation?
It is pretty much like a diary, but I come up with a subject and then I talk through it, and there's a lot of interaction with my audience as well.
Nice.
Right. Yeah. And how easy or difficult is vlogging? I mean, because you kind of have to be driven to kind of get into the routine of releasing the videos and managing that whole process. And I think that's where a lot of people kind of fall off.
Yeah, you do have to take your own initiative and set your own schedules. And you are your own boss, essentially. And you don't always have someone to work with to tell you this is right, this is wrong. You've got to make all your own decisions.
Yeah.
So the pressure is on in that sense, but it's also a wonderful job to have.
Right.
But what's the motivation for you to keep doing it and keeping it new every day?
Well, because people are expecting new videos every week. I'm a weekly vlogger. So people wait on a Saturday. It's kind of like people are waiting for the Weekend Edition, you know? They're waiting for the video.
Oh, so there's a specific time that it goes out every Saturday?
Usually, yes.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I try and stick to a weekly schedule.
Nice.
And you speak to a specific audience. It's obviously young people. And is it young women in particular?
Yeah, the majority are women, but I am getting a few males in there as well, which I'm super proud of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Take us through some of the issues that you deal with or some of the things in your life that you cover.
Coming-of-age topics mostly.
Okay.
Depression, bullying, losing your virginity.
Wow.
Menstrual cycles.
Okay.
She's actually got a video now that we could look at.
Yeah.
All right.
Where she tells us or asks us if she should go in the pool, so I think we should check it out.
All right.
So if you are considering going on the pill, I encourage you to, yes, watch this video, but to also go and speak to a doctor before making any final decision. So what does the pill actually do? In a nutshell, if the pill is taken correctly, it'll stop a woman from ovulating, which means no little human baby will be able to be formed in the uterus because there are no eggs being released to be fertilized by sperm. There are two types of pills on the market. There's the combination pill, which is the one that I take, and then there's something called the mini pill. I'm not gonna sit here and tell you what you should take,
just explore your options. Apart from contraception, the pill also has an effect on your period. And me being the period lady, of course I'm gonna bring this up. Every month when the woman takes her inactive pills, which are these white ones right at the bottom here, I don't know if you can see, it's quite shiny. During this time, the woman will bleed. This is a much shorter, lighter version of a natural period. This is because the pill suppresses your endometrium from thickening. Because you're not ovulating, and therefore your uterus doesn't need to feed a tiny little baby, so there's not a lot to shed. So now we know that the pill stops us from ovulating and getting natural periods. But what's so great about the pill? Why do so many women take it? Well, one big bonus is that you can have safe sex with your partner without having to use any other contraceptive, if, of course, the two of you have been tested for STDs. Because there is nothing fun about receiving an STD because, you know, you didn't check up and you went on the pill and you were like, yay, I'm safe. You're not safe from STDs. You're safe from pregnancy. just reminding you.
right. And how old is your average follower or viewer?
My analytics, according to my analytics, 18 to 24. But I do feel like there might be some younger viewers.
Some oldies are watching you.
Yeah, some oldies.
Old. Yeah.
But I do think that it's also, there are a lot of younger viewers as well who maybe haven't disclosed their age.
All right, now there's a menstrual cups in versus tampons video that you posted,
there
right?
There is, yes.
Is there a tug of war between the two? I wouldn't know.
Like, there is.
Yeah.
Cup scares me.
Oh, it does?
It does.
It does.
The whole cup thing.
You haven't tried it?
No, I haven't tried it. Just the whole thought. No. Scares me.
You should try, though. I mean, it's really revolutionary. I would never go back.
Really?
Yeah. So I had to share it with my audience, and that's why... That's why we have these videos on my channel.
Why is it scary for you? I don't know what this is, by the way. I don't know what it looks like. Yeah.
So don't ask.
I actually have one in my bag. I should show it to you later.
Please.
Yeah.
I want to see what it is that you're so afraid of.
Yeah.
What's your methodology? I mean, we saw there, like, how many cameras are you using? And technically, what's your cycle for putting together the videos? Is it, like, what can you tell us? What software are you using?
Really nice.
How are you editing the stuff? Is that a set or is that actually your room?
Yeah, it's actually my room, but sometimes I might put some candles in the background, make it look, you know, tidy it up, things like that.
Give us some ambiance.
Yeah, so I've got to obviously come up with my idea.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll go to Twitter and say, what do you guys feel like this week, to get inspiration.
Yeah.
And then I'll write a brief script. I try not to stick to scripts too harshly.
Yeah.
Too harshly. And then I'll set up my camera and my tripod. I only have one tripod and one camera.
And how many lights?
I have one light. Everything's just one. Me.
Yes.
All on my own doing that. And I will edit the footage afterwards using Final Cut Pro X, which is a great editing software for beginners and people who are just making YouTube videos and they don't have to do crazy special effects and things like that. Mm.
I'm so annoyed with myself. I've got like five cameras at home.
But you never use them.
Never get used. My son's supposed to use them, but like... I need to get my act together.
But you're not bad on social media.
I'm terrible. How do you get followers as a YouTube blogger?
It's really hard to say, because if I knew the answer, everyone would be doing it.
So you just post a video, and then somehow, naturally and organically, people will notice it?
Share probably the feed. Probably.
There has to be... What's your methodology is what I'm asking.
Initially,
is it a secret?
They're going to take it.
Is it a secret?
Yeah, because it's
really
going to take her numbers.
Okay.
I mean, hard work. That's really hard work.
Make some phone calls. Make some cold calls. Right, okay.
Yeah.
Wow. All right. Thursday, 29 September, you launched a Lily Cup project that helps empower girls who do not have enough money for sanitary products.
Yeah.
I know that this is quite a big deal all throughout the country. Many different provinces are engaged in this. How did the project come about?
Well, a viewer watched one of my videos about tampons versus menstrual cups, and she had been involved in a project where she was donating pads to those who needed them, but realized that they weren't sustainable. And when she heard about these menstrual cups, or Lily cups, which I used, she thought, well, those would be much more sustainable, and if we were to be able to give these girls a cup, it'll last for 10 years as opposed to just helping them with one or two periods.
Oh, the cup. Oh.
Scary.
The cup run full.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, so it's an actual cup.
Yes.
It is an actual
cup. And it's a reusable cup.
Yes.
Well, that's genius.
I know, isn't it? It's amazing, yeah. So I've been able to donate 4,000 of those cups.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's 4,000 young women who will never have to buy any sanitary pads or anything for the next 10 years.
I know.
That's
incredible. It's an amazing gift. And I was gifted one once. And I think when I got it, I thought, this is something that I want to give to others.
You still have it?
I still have it, of course.
Yeah. How many years? Sorry, I digress. listen, you're gonna still hang out with us.
Yes, of course.
We're gonna do some cooking, and we're gonna introduce you to some of the other guys who've joined us today. But right now, we're gonna take a short break. But before we do you ever wonder what a world with no cars would be like, and whether that world would be fun? Yeah.
Because you don't use a car.
I don't.
But for me, it would be very difficult and scary. Yeah.
Well, here's an amazing weekend activity in the Cape Town-based township called Langa. Take a look at this.
For the third time, King Langalibalele Drive in Langa was dedicated to people instead of cars for just a few hours. Open Streets Langa provided an opportunity to explore a street as a space that connects people and a reimagining of public life.
So Open Streets is a global movement to use our streets differently. On a regular basis, you know, this space is full of traffic, and today, by closing it down to cars, we're inviting people to own it as public space. We believe streets can be more than they are. So we are not maximizing the potential of this space. We believe that streets can be places where people can connect, where people can have a choice in how they move around the city, where, you know, there's an opportunity to express ourselves. So with this, we're basically giving people a platform.
Closing off streets to vehicular traffic creates a shared space, and it works towards more integrated, safer, and vibrant cities where streets embody respect for all people.
When we remove cars from streets, they become places that people get to enjoy, they become human friendly, and for the transport department, it assists us in spreading the message around sharing the space, sharing the road, and so it encourages for us non-motorized transport, cycling or walking as an alternative to driving a private car.
To get to an Open Streets event, visitors are encouraged to make use of public transport, and the local transport authorities give their full support to this unique gathering.
Transport for Cape Town has been a long supporter of Open Streets. We have provided professional support in terms of road closures, but also financial support to make sure that these events happen. And we have been doing so for the last 3 or 4 years.
With the transport and street taken care of, it's up to the people to arrange activities that become the attractions, from fun aerobics and dance to art classes.
My favorite part is as soon as the cars are out, and all the kids just flock in. There's something so magic about just having that space. You don't need to tell people what to do. In particular, when kids come to the table and I give them chalk, this again, this one moment where they just go, I can draw on the street, and then you have 20 people that come and draw. That's my favorite part of Open Streets.
One of the most interesting attractions was Lifeline's Sidewalk Talk, a community project where passers-by could share their feelings and thoughts with a trained listener.
It was an opportunity to be with the community, different communities. Often people don't know that there is somebody who is available, who cares, and you can talk to them about anything. Now we've got some chairs out. People are able to come and say, this is what's on my heart, this is what worries me, this is what I'm excited about. And so we're here, we're all counselors with Lifeline. Here we're in the community, and you'll see behind me people are just saying, this is what's happening in my life. I'm so glad there's somebody I can talk to.
Our activity is See You Do That Yoga, and we are doing yoga in Langa, and we both love yoga, and our lives have changed because of it.
It's an opportunity for people to come and showcase their work locally, and because there's so much activity happening in the community that nobody knows about, so it's a great opportunity for us to come together, people in the community, people outside of the community.
Indeed, what makes this event so special is that many visitors from other areas of the city come into the township with a sincere desire to get to know the community and meet new people.
My experience here in Open Streets today has been amazing because I've met a lot of wonderful people and I've witnessed a lot of diverse cultures and diverse people coming from many areas in Cape Town, others from foreign countries as well, but they're here today in the township.
So far it's been great. It's a lovely place full of very different people mixing it up. It's crazy that it's only these kinds of events that brings this kind of diversity. This is the way it should be.
even if just for a few hours, one street becomes a true reflection of the Rainbow Nation. Citizens smiling and moving together on a road that leads towards true unity.
So put your car aside and take a walk with me on the streets of Langa because I want to do it. But today we're making pizza, so bring the kids, bring your friends. It's pizza night. Hashtag the weekend edition. See you after the break. It's a weekend.
Welcome back, guys. We're in the kitchen. We're all surrounding Ilse. Ilse is going to show us with her beautiful modeling hands how to make a pizza. And this I love because with my son, ever since he was a toddler, every Friday has always been pizza night. And it was his night. We get him a movie. But we never made a pizza, which I think is cool because people don't realize how easy pizza is to make. Yeah.
Is it easy?
Yeah.
Extremely easy to
really?
Make.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why does it look
like
everything?
See?
And also,
I'm like you.
And it's nice, you've got all the dough, you can make like a few pizzas.
Right.
You can get the family to come together, each one can build their own pizza, and you bake one pizza at a time, and everyone tastes, and you choose a winner. You know, you can make a fun game with the kids.
Right. Now, the pizza we're making today, is there something special about the pizza? Is there something special about the dough? Because I think it can disappear with... Why are you playing the... You're playing the kitchen counter. She's like, pizza, oh my goodness.
I actually don't eat carbs, so I try and stay away from them.
Oh, wow.
I'll be very honest. Like, I've also been cutting carbs, so pizza isn't something I often make, so it's a special...
But the kids eat carbs, so let's make a pizza.
So let's show them how to do that. Okay.
Right.
So for the dough, I mean, it's straightforward. Okay, very straightforward. So we're going to take our flour, we're going to take our semolina. I like to add a bit of semolina to the flour because it gives the pizza
texture.
A little bit of more texture. It's right. A little bit crunchier. So we're just going to mix the two together.
And what is that, semolina?
Semolina. Yeah, it's almost like a corn flour. Like
oh.
A, yeah.
Okay. Isn't it wheat-based?
It's wheat, I think.
Yeah, it's, yeah. Oh, it's cool, yeah. Sure.
So, okay, but now there's so many different ways of making... I mean, like, pizza has turned into, like, so many different things now. It used to be that you had to put it in the oven first, bake it and bring it out, and then put the toppings on and then put it back in. But now people are doing it different. It's almost like the dough has changed.
It all depends.
Yeah.
I prefer, like, if you do something that's got fresh ingredients,
yeah.
You'll do the base first and then put the fresh ingredients on top. But if it's something
right.
That you would like to cook on the pizza, you
yeah.
Put that first.
Right.
So, you know, you'll see today, most of the pizzas, we only cook something on the base, like a sauce.
Right.
Take it out, and then you add your fresh ingredients.
Right.
Especially for summer now. I'm going to show you quite a few nice things for summer.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
So now you've got your little hole in the flour.
Right. We love the hole in the
yes.
Flour, yeah?
Okay. So we're going to add some sugar here.
Took me a minute to get there.
No, I was talking about the dough. What's wrong with you guys? Yeah.
You're going to add your yeast.
Oh, is that yeast?
Yeah.
Okay.
A little bit of salt here. Yeah, do you want to eat that?
I'm just curious to see what the yeast tastes like.
Okay, and then you add your lukewarm water. The yeast needs a bit of warm water to start, you know, growing and
Chris,
all nice,
is this something
yeah.
That you would ever make?
We make pizza at home. My family, we really enjoy Italian food. We've got a pizza oven, but I've never seen it done this way.
Oh, yeah, so. Like there's so many different ways of doing
yeah.
It, right? How
but
do you
it's
guys
on
make
a
it?
Counter. That's what's so interesting for me. It's literally
yeah.
On a counter.
But this is kind of the old-fashioned way to do it. Like, if you have a nice mixer,
yes.
It's much easier if you have a dough attachment. You just chuck everything in there. So we'll slowly but surely just incorporate the flour into the liquid.
It's kind of like a volcano there.
Yeah. It's like a well.
Yeah, yes. A well or a dam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It works really well with a whisk as well. Just like when it starts getting to the dough consistency, get the whisk out of there because
right.
You can have lots of dough stuck in there.
Right.
But
it's cool. It's quite like a cool little chemistry class for kids
yeah.
As well. They get
yeah.
To see
you
the
get
whole
all
thing
the, yeah, involved.
Transform,
and,
right.
Yeah, right. And each kid can add an ingredient and, you know, make it some fun.
So, Chris, what, you guys had like ready-made dough at home?
No, we'll do it like this back at home. All from scratch, you know, do the base ourselves,
yeah.
Everything, and you know, it's really good.
Yeah. So, and the nice thing is that you can, I don't know if you've seen, but a lot of people have these like pizza ovens for the braai. So if you have a grown-up party, you invite all your friends and they build their own pizzas and you also do the same thing. You cook one pizza at a time and everyone tastes.
I actually have one of those.
Nice.
You
really nice,
you.
Yeah.
Fancy. And very
it's a,
fancy.
Hold on, so it's a braai stand. What is it, like a one of those pit ovens that heats up to 800 degrees?
I think it's Spanish or Mexican.
Yeah.
And it's got like a hole on the side where you can put in your pizza.
Wow.
So
wow.
I can see it's getting together.
Oh, I see.
And it's not one of my favorite things to get dough stuck under my nails, so I'll rather work it with a spoon until it's pretty good.
Okay.
Okay.
Looks like it's a bit dry.
I didn't add all the water now, so we can just add
you're going to add more water?
Yeah.
More water.
So the dough is still nice and warm, and the yeast is going to start doing its thing, obviously. Yeah. But it's very important to work the dough as well, because of the gluten, you're going to get that elasticity. Yeah. And that's why if you're gluten-free, it's difficult to get that.
There's just something extra sexy about making dough in the kitchen.
That you do.
My mind just went there. Yeah. I don't know. Like, my mom makes pizza from scratch. She prefers to make it from scratch as well. But she's never like allowed me in the kitchen to partake and participate in the process. Yeah.
Now imagine what the kitchen would look like.
Right.
This is so interesting.
Okay, so now it's kind of like just like pushing it over and pulling it.
Right.
You'll see I didn't add all the water, so I'm not using all the flour.
And then at some point, will you have to start throwing it in the
air? Yeah, I'm also waiting for that.
Yeah, I'm waiting
for that. Get it up close to that camera.
Right.
So how many pizzas should we get out of this?
Depending on the size. I would say about six.
Oh, wow.
Six slices or six pizzas?
Six pizzas.
Yeah.
Wow.
Six pizzas, yeah.
All right. Okay. So how long would it take?
You've got to need this for quite a while.
All right.
Okay, so I'm going to stop very soon and I'm going to take the product that we've already done before.
Yeah, let's pull out the ready-made dough, girl. You're killing yourself here.
But I just kind of want to like, okay, so when this is almost ready, you'll see it becomes more elastic. Okay.
Right.
So the way to know that it's kind of ready for you to let it proof.
Yeah.
You know what proof is?
No.
Okay, so. You just said yeah. Because no. We want to sound stupid. Yeah.
So if you proof the dough, it basically sits in a warm temperature and it doubles in volume because the yeast is obviously working its magic. So normally, how you know it's ready for this piece of dough to go and sit and rest is when you push your finger in and it bounces back.
Right.
It's perfect. So what you would do is you would take your bowl, add a little bit of olive oil at the bottom. We've got olive oil here.
Okay.
A little bit of olive oil, just so it doesn't get stuck to the bottom. Just put it in there. And now it's important to take a nice damp cloth and cover it.
Why damp?
Because yeast loves warm temperature and dampness to make grow. So, and if you have a warm spot in your house, move it there. I like to put it next to the oven when it's running. Mm-hmm. So you've got, and it also proves much quicker. Okay.
As in next to a warm oven, or just
an oven, period.
If the oven is on, yeah. I mean,
come on.
It's not really good.
Question two. I was like, maybe there's something.
There's no such thing as a stupid question.
So yeah.
Oh wow. Okay. And that's what it looks like.
You can
like.
See what happened here. It was down here and it's gone up there.
Wow. Okay. It's very stringy as well.
Mm. Yeah. So luckily I still have lots of flour left here. So I'm gonna not put my fingers in yet because you can see. You can smell it, eh? Mm.
Yeah, it's like
the
beer.
Yeast. Yeah.
It's like beer.
Yeah, it smells like beer.
So you can also use that glad wrap stuff to put on top instead of the cloth or not?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. But I would prefer the cloth because it's damp and you're adding that little bit of moisture to it. So
let's
put that there.
Okay, so now what it's called is we're knocking down the dough, basically. So you're getting all the air out of there. You're going to work with it a little bit more. So from here, you can go straight and do your portions, roll out and start doing your pizza. Or you can do your portions. And what I like to do, so you can do this before your guests arrive. You portion it and you basically do a small ball like this and just press it down. Put it in the fridge, cling wrap. Take it out when you need it, 15 to 20 minutes before, roll it out, and there you go.
Ah.
Okay.
So you can preset everything.
Yeah, so you're just gonna do like a beautiful little roll, and you're gonna take a knife. Do we have a knife here?
We used to have a knife.
Here we go. And then you will cut your portions, so depending on your size of pizza. So we'll cut your portions.
That looks like a small pizza.
It rolls out pretty thin.
I'm just saying.
It looks like a biscuit.
So when you order a thick-based pizza, what does that mean? They didn't roll. They didn't make it too thin, right?
They don't make it too thin. No.
But I also think it's how you make the dough as well. It depends on how thin and how thick you can make the crust, isn't
it? Yeah. I prefer you like a thin, crispy.
Okay. All right. So that's the basics of how to make your dough.
Straightforward, easy. I mean, it's really there's nothing special that you need to be able to do.
What's the substitute for flour? Let's say you have banting or something.
You get tapioca flour, you get... for banting, you know what, for banting, if anyone's made a banting pizza, the only way you really can do it is with cauliflower as a base. Mm-hmm. Because any other kind of flour, even though it's gluten-free, has got carbs. Mm-hmm. So you can't really get away with that. So your cauliflower-based pizza is your best option for when you're banting.
And that one's nasty.
The cauliflower. The
tofu cauliflower cracker. One. Huh? A tofu cracker pizza. All right. Guys, we're going to be making pizzas now. Now you know how to make the dough. We're going to actually get real fancy from here on out. You don't want to miss what we're going to do next. But we're going to take a short break. Don't forget, all our recipes are on our Facebook page, The Weekend on 3. Otherwise, we're hashtag The Weekend Edition all across social media. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We're sitting here with a celebrity blogger.
Yes. A girl is living my life.
Born in Zimbabwe.
Yes.
Now living in the United States with your Zimbabwean husband.
That's exactly right. Right? Yes.
Who's a software engineer. I know. Don't blind us, girl. Dang. But you're living in New York as a celebrity blogger and reporter. Mm-hmm. And who do you report and blog for?
So at this current time, I work with Essence
Magazine. Hold on. Makho Ndlovu.
Yes.
We gotta say her name.
Goes without saying. Just dive right into it.
Okay. So we're gonna check out a clip of your work. You wanna tell us what it is that we're gonna be watching?
So
it's your showreel, right?
I'm actually as surprised as you are, but I believe we're gonna be watching my showreel. It's a reel, kind of represents the work that I've done and the work that I'm doing in New York now.
Okay, let's check it out.
Makho for Global Grind, and we're live at MTV Video Music Awards. Don't interview me. I'm interviewing y'all. No. She's also the number one model in
She's
the world.
She's living my life.
Okay,
man.
Do you watch reality TV at all?
I belong on those streets.
Why are you drooling?
I belong on those streets.
But your time is coming. By the way, Africa's having a moment. Let's look at all these celebrities that are in Hollywood that are African descent. Don't you wait. Your
Idris.
Time is coming.
It's coming, right?
Idris, Lupita, Danai.
Pearl Tusi.
I'm talking about Pearl Tusi.
right.
Pearl Tusi. Yeah, there's so many of us. And even
Trevor
in music.
Trevor Noah,
you know? So I think we've been fly. Africa's been fly. But the rest of the world is starting to catch up. So it's really exciting to be in the mix of that.
And then all the top Billboard hits are Afro-pop.
Afro-beat. Look at Drake and Wizkid. I mean, we could go on and on and on. So I'm really excited about
Coffee's
this moment.
Black Coffee's making it in the States now. Yeah. So.
Can I tell you that when Black Coffee comes to perform in New York, the line to get in is around the corner.
Right.
It goes around the block. It wraps around the entire block. And his music has just transcended. It's transcended race, it's transcended cultural lines, and he just has a way of bringing people together. So he's
What's
also
the fascination with Africa currently?
I think it starts sort of as a, there's one thing that sparks it, and then it becomes like a ripple effect, right? Wow. And I feel like Lupita was at the right place at the right time, and she's been really good about, you know, using her career and not putting and thrusting Africa in the spotlight and like using it as a means to showcase her career. But she's used it at the right point in time. For instance, we've seen Queen of Katwe.
Yes.
She's bought the rights to Americana. And I think within that, she's worked with Danai Gurira, who is a playwright, and they've done Eclipse. And Danai has gotten some shine off of that, and she's in The Walking Dead. So I think it's been sort of a succession of events, and Trevor Noah, as we mentioned. Mm. And I think that's, unfortunately, it may seem like a phase, but I think the level of talent that's in the continent is so amazing that it cannot be a phase. It's just going to be a part of global culture.
But even before Lupita, who's the Zimbabwean director who did that movie with
is this Cedric the Entertainer? Not Cedric, with Terrence Howard and about the swimming team in Philadelphia.
Oh, really?
There's a Zimbabwean director who
okay,
did
so
that.
Then
yeah, you see what I mean?
Like, people. Like,
yeah.
You need to introduce me.
You don't know that? You don't know that?
No, you don't know that.
Your people need to call my people?
Your people need to call my people, and we need to be friends.
Yeah, all right. What's your day like? Mm. You're a celebrity blogger in a big city, probably arguably the biggest media city in the world.
Yeah.
What's your day like? You must have a lot of options on a day-to-day.
So my day is very different, depending. All my days are very different.
And you can
so,
do a red carpet. You can do 5 red carpet events in New York every single
every
day.
Every single day. There is no shortage of celebrities. Yeah. I walk outside and Bruce Willis is walking down the street, right?
Yeah.
You go to the corner restaurant and Solange Knowles is hanging out.
Yeah.
No shortage of celebrities. So essentially what I do is I am a self-owned entity. I freelance and I work with different companies. So I've worked with Global Brand, I've worked with BET Africa, and currently I'm with Essence. Mm. So first and foremost, I'm always making sure that I have a job because New York City is very expensive and a sister gotta pay bills.
Girl.
You did say
that's
this.
Number one. New York
people
you
think
say
they
it.
Can just
rock
you
up
didn't
in
say
New York.
It. You didn't
no,
say it.
No,
you would be part of the B&T crowd across state. Yeah.
Yeah. So I make sure that I'm always working on a project. And then secondly, I make sure that I'm pitching myself to different companies. And I also don't wait to get assignments, right?
Right.
So for instance, with Essence
Because you can do
magazine,
stuff and send it in and they'll pay for it,
absolutely.
Right?
So I'm always pitching. I see what red carpet events are coming in or Kanye's in town. Okay, I think she'd be a really good fit for Essence. I think she'd be a good fit for OK Africa. So I reach out to them and say, hey, this is what Kanye's working on. These are the projects. I have a relationship with her. Let's do a story on her. Mm. Or there's this red carpet. I can get access, let me cover this event. So that's essentially what my day looks like. It's a lot of email, a lot of admin.
Keeping your ear on the ground, basically,
yeah,
to know what's happening.
Yeah, I get to dress up and look cute sometimes and meet some celebrities.
But isn't that expensive? Or do you have someone who dresses
well,
you up like a stylist?
Well, it helps to have a software engineer for
husband,
you know.
Husband.
Keeps us right and tight. So it does get very expensive. It gets So I've had to learn how to do my own makeup.
I mean, even Pearl is like, listen, I'm not going
out. I know, because
I'm just gonna do my job.
Actually, Pearl lives 5 minutes away from my house.
What area is she in?
She's in Brooklyn.
Okay.
And I'm in Williamsburg. I won't give away where she lives because she might not want me to do that.
Yeah.
But she lives 5 minutes away, so I often take an Uber to go visit her, and she's really sweet, and I'm so happy for her success.
Yeah.
Like
all of
she
us.
Did. She
all
deserves it. So she actually took me to, this is a humble brag. Are y'all ready?
Yeah.
I have a little bit of a humble brag.
All right,
okay. She took me to Priyanka Chopra's house.
Oh, yeah, which is, I hear, is epic.
Oh.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Was it for one of the viewing nights when the show premiered?
So it was the premiere of Quantico.
Right, so it was a big
party
there.
The house is amazing. First of all, I've already explained that New York City houses are like super expensive.
So it's a penthouse.
It's a penthouse.
Yeah.
There's an upstairs, there's a downstairs, there's a
movie theater. Yeah.
What?
There's an upstairs, like a rooftop. And then Blair Underwood was there. Blair had his arms around me. I had to look at my ring. I was like, I love my husband. I really do. Because he looks so good. He's in his 50s and he just does not age. Like, that black don't crack.
Did Pearl take you there with her driver?
Her driver, we actually met a driver.
Her driver's pretty cool.
She has a driver in New York?
Of course.
Really?
She's not driving herself.
That's that Quantico money. See, that's why Kanye's trying to come to New York. She can't get that Quantico money.
Living here, we think we're nice.
Speaking of money, how do you make money blogging?
So I actually don't make money blogging.
Okay.
Be very, very honest.
So you sell stories to publications.
That's
right.
That's how I make my money. I sell myself as a person who can provide content. Mm. Blogging it's been difficult for me to navigate, but what I like about blogging is that it's sort of created a brand awareness. Mm. Like, people know about me because of my blog
it's
and my social
media.
It's a new
style, a new form of reporting. Like, you have to create yourself, create a little bit of celebrity around what
you
do. Yeah.
And speaking of Pearl, I actually broke her story, the Quantico story, because I was snooping and spying and having
my eyes. She wasn't telling anyone,
right? Like, if we knew each other back then, I probably would have slid in your DMs and be like, yo.
What's happening?
But I guess I told her, I said, it's Quantico, and she just denied it.
She denied it. What are you talking about? So
yeah.
I spotted her on Priyanka Chopra's Instagram page, and I just looked at that
afro and
that face. I was like, that's Pearl Toosey.
Yeah.
And she denied. She didn't respond to my tweets. She didn't respond to my messages. And I was trending in South Africa. I was so excited. So, it's a new form of breaking stories and breaking journalism. And the thing is, I really want to come at it from a very positive perspective.
Yeah.
I think there's so much negativity in the world, and there's so much room for so many women to keep going and, you know, do fabulous things, and I want to be the ambassador in breaking those stories.
So you don't want to do, like, a gossip and break
No, that's
down.
Not for me.
Yeah.
Like, if I talk crap about Kanye and now we're sitting next to each other, like, how awkward is that?
It changes.
But that's what I do.
That's what you do?
Yeah, for a living.
Exactly what I do.
He's a boss abroad.
And I'll still come in your face and smile and be like, what's up?
That's that industry stuff. No, we need to create more positivity. I'm all about creating positive images and just general positivity amongst women.
All right. Well, Makho, thank you for coming to hang out with us. You're still going to stick around. We still have to make some pizzas, right? We're going to take a short break. People can check out your stuff, right?
Please. Yes. On Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. It's all at Makho Ndlovu. And my blog is www.makhondlovu.com.
All right. Yeah. We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. We can, Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We're sitting here with legendary musician extraordinaire, political activist.
Stop it, I like
I'll come after you on Twitter and then lullaby you to sleep with my music, Simphiwe Dana.
And fights for women.
I don't like your tone. I don't come after nobody.
No, but my tone is very sweet. You did. Well, you didn't. Okay, maybe they came after you and you were defending yourself? What was it?
No, we're having a healthy conversation.
Oh, okay. But it always came across as if you were, like, gloves off.
Well, I mean, it does get a bit tense when we're talking about things that are close to our hearts, you know, as in any debate, for that matter.
So you describe yourself as an activist. Were you, when you were younger, were you part of some of the political organizations, community organizations? Did you do any...
I've never been a part of any organization.
Oh, okay. So when you describe yourself as an activist, what do you mean?
I basically bring to light things that I'm passionate about, injustices, you know, and just generally things.
Do you mean through your music, or you mean like when you're given a platform sometimes, you just...
She's given a platform, I think.
I mean, my music does tend to address a lot of that, but I go beyond just the music. For instance, I did like an education tour some years back, where I wanted to just understand for myself what the issue was in the education system, especially in the rural communities where I come from, because my understanding was that regardless of the fact that there was no infrastructure, as long as the teachers themselves were passionate about what they were doing and they had a know-how of what to do, then, you know, kids would still get a good education, because I did have that. So I wanted to go and find out for myself what the real issue was, because I felt it went beyond just, you know,
and what did you find?
Infrastructure. Well, one of the things that I found that... actually shocked me was the issue of language, that mother tongue education is very urgent, and it's one of the biggest stumbling blocks when it comes to whether, you know, kids pass or not. I found that to be the biggest issue, actually, more than anything else. And then, you know, the fact that teachers are not as revered as they used to be back in the day, because back in the day they were seen almost the same as we saw preachers and people like that. So they were not as elevated, and, you know, they didn't have as elevated a status as they used to back in the day. And therefore, they also didn't carry themselves, you know, as important people, which is why you found that there's more kids getting pregnant by teachers and kids drinking with teachers and shebeens and all of that. And that also was a factor.
Yeah. What do you think caused that? Because you're right, teachers and education as a whole was something that was taken seriously and revered by society, and now it seems like it's like, you know,
it's just a guy doing his
sign with Mabala noise, I'll be fine.
Well, the thing is this, you know, teachers, lawyers, clerks, and to an extent nurses as well, they were revered because those were like the highest...
even policemen at some point.
The jobs that black people would
get, right? Yeah. We know they would qualify mostly in these four fields. Yes. So, but now you get engineers, you get mathematicians, you get accountants. So many other people that are qualified, yeah. You know, even more than teachers are. Yeah. So I think perhaps that was also a factor.
It's fallen away. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, let's talk about your upbringing. Your father was a preacher. Do you think that...
Was.
What? Oh, he's no longer. Did he leave?
No.
Has he left the... That is an amazing story. Has he left the gospel?
Yes.
What happened?
By the time I was born, or by the time, you know, I was aware,
yeah.
He was no longer a preacher. So I've never known him as a preacher at all.
And is he still a staunch Christian and... Does he reference the Bible?
I don't live with him.
Oh, okay, all right.
I'll pass.
Because I was going to ask, why did you not pursue a career in gospel music? But then obviously, clearly.
Well, I mean, actually, the gospel influence in my life was my mom, not my father.
Okay.
And she still is a very staunch Christian, even today. And she still really wants me to go back to church and, you know...
Sing gospel.
Because I used to be a staunch Christian myself.
Used to be? She said used to be.
Yes,
she
didn't underline.
The gospel as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And make it bold, underline.
Used to.
Capital letters. Well, I'm still a very spiritual person. Mm. And I do not trample on people's religions. I actually have lots of respect for them. But I personally, I prefer the more spiritual connection rather than religion has got too many laws and rules and biases and all of that. It's not for me.
Okay. And let's talk about some of your music. Obviously, your first huge album was Zandisile. Mm-hmm. And how many albums have you released since then? That was back in 2002, was it?
2004.
Right.
I've released four albums in total so far, and plus a live recording, DVD. Yes.
And you've got another big live event on the way as well, right?
You guys know about that?
Yeah.
You're the first ones to know.
but before we talk about that, so it's been about what, 8 years? So you take about 2 years per album?
3 to 4 years.
Is that on purpose? Because in
ask.
This fast world, it seems like
people
are releasing...
Because people want an album
releasing,
every year.
Well, I mean, there's a market for that, for releasing every year. For me, I draw my inspiration from my own personal experiences. So, therefore, I need time to actually experience new stuff to be able to create new material.
Yeah.
So, therefore, I'm okay taking my time. And, you know, I'm not a pop artist that needs to come up with new trends for every December kind of a thing.
Yeah.
So I'm fine with that. I like that. You know, every December, let's have a hit song, guys. You know,
Oh, you need it as well.
I do, of course.
But you're just not that type of artist.
What's
your favorite song for this year so far?
Babes would do more.
Of course.
You too, you're also there.
Are you serious?
Everybody's there.
Well, it's fun.
Yeah, it is fun.
And I think it's about time we had some fun.
But like, you're such a serious musician. I always feel, and this is just my own personal bias, that serious musicians look at like dance music in a very condescending sort of way. Like, you guys are only playing two chords there.
Yes.
There's only three lyrics. But like, how do you view pop music? As a musician?
It's not serious music, right?
Okay.
It's to bring happiness and joy.
Yes, and bring people together.
And bring people together, both adults and young people dancing together to Babes Won't Do More. That's fun. Fun is good.
Yeah.
We can't always be serious.
Yeah. I had the same conversation with Mdu the other day. And he was telling me that a lot of the serious musicians didn't like what they were doing.
Yes.
Especially back
like
in the 90s.
Yeah, that whole two-chord thing.
No, it doesn't work. It's like, dude.
At least there's some improvement now.
No, there is some improvement, but yeah. Yeah, he told me about making an entire song from like a simple Casio keyboard.
Yes, and that's
those days, they moved on. Yeah.
That's all. It's like this. They use two fingers, and that's it.
What instruments do you play?
My only instrument is my voice.
Oh, so you don't play any music?
But when I'm writing, I have a mini MIDI keyboard at home where I create my melodies.
So you are able to sort of play a...
No, I just create the melodies.
The melodies.
Also, you like Tabum Beki. Doesn't he type like this?
No, he doesn't
need
type like this.
I know, right. In Kwezi, I did that.
Yeah.
Mayine, I did that.
Wow.
Which other songs? Quite a few songs from Culture Noir. Culture Noir is when I started seriously thinking, you know, I could create melodies myself. So
yeah.
Some of my biggest songs on Culture Noir, I created them, right? Okay. But
is it because the technology enables you? Because I always marvel now DJs creating music and they're tone deaf.
Yes.
Is it because of technology that you're able to do that?
Do DJs create music now?
The music that brings people together that you so enjoy every December.
He's a musician.
He's a musician.
Yeah. He's a musician, but
he studied music.
Okay. He actually studied.
He has a degree in music.
The other one is Cleo. Cleo is also a musician.
Yeah, Maskandi particularly.
But I mean, you can be a musician without going to school, like me.
Raw talent, yeah.
You know?
Okay. So that's what I was asking. Is it because of the technology and it's enabled you to do that? Or even without the technology, you think you could put together music without knowing how to play an instrument?
I do, you know, in my band. I can say, can you play this melody? Can you play this on the bass? Can you do that? I'd have two left hands.
Yeah.
I cannot play an instrument. I've tried.
Okay.
I'm just like...
It doesn't work.
Yeah.
You know?
But you got your voice.
But my voice is my instrument. When I first started, I would write my songs a cappella.
Yeah.
In their, you know, entirety.
And then musicians would have to...
Add in their own.
Well, I mean, it's easy when the song is there. You know, everything is there. You just draw from it. Which is why, like, issues of composition can be very tricky in that case. And then, you know, technology, I mean, I did IT, so I could put together my own little studios. And once I got a MIDI keyboard, I was gone.
It's over.
You were gone. You're doing your own thing.
Yes.
All right, so we're going to talk about this big experience you've got happening in November. And then also, you're going to stick around and we're going to continue cooking in the kitchen, right? Making some pizzas, even though...
Are you guys going to call me to come and cook, by the way? Because, you put on a challenge. You said that you make better curries than me.
Listen, my baby's sitting over there. She's shaking her head. You don't want this.
Sure.
You know what I think we need? No. Just go perform a song. Give us something...
Actually shows that you don't follow me on Instagram. Because if you did, you would not even dare.
But you can't taste Instagram.
She's taking you on.
You can't taste it. But we can hear your music. Here's Simphiwe Dana performing on the Weekend Edition.
Finally.
Okay, the next song we're doing for you is called Inkwenkwezi. Inkwenkwezi means a star, and the song says that wherever you are, I hope you shine bright like a star.
Bunga, Nkwenkwezi.
Yeah, I think she's forgotten about that crazy wager.
She's still going to take you on, though. I don't think she forgets. Let me know, who do you think is going to win if they had to have a curry cook-off? Hashtag the weekend edition. See you after the break. Stop.
Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We've got extreme filmmaker, is that right? Extreme filmmaker Chris Rogers.
How's it going? Stoked to be here.
I don't know what it is about your name. It's got me thinking about Buck Rogers.
Yeah.
Right? Did you ever watch that show, Buck Rogers?
No. No.
You're too young. So, okay.
Probably.
Yeah. It's another generation. Welcome to the Weekend Edition, dude.
Thanks. Stoked to be here.
So you do crazy stuff. You travel to crazy places and you capture that.
Yeah. Travel, try as much.
Do you film the stuff on your own or do you have a crew that travels with you?
No. Most of the time, I'm traveling solo, but I have a lot of filmmaking friends from around the world, so I'll try to link up with them and we'll shoot something together and just go crazy with it.
Right.
Yeah.
So, like, what are some of the types of things that you like to film?
Oh, anything that really gets the adrenaline going, you know, from surfing in Namibia to snowboarding in the Alps to wakeboarding in the Philippines, anything that really gets you, you know, gets the adrenaline going.
Have you done any of those crazy waves? Like, I hear just off the coast of Kamiki, there's like a 100-foot wave.
Yeah,
or
Dungeons. Yeah, it's a big wave. No, I don't.
You don't do those. Waves.
I just made a little strike mission to Jeffreys Bay about 2 days ago. That was fun. But I guess it's kind of addictive, but I really enjoy action sports.
Right, so what are some of the crazy places you've traveled to?
This year I've done quite a lot of Europe. I went to the States, I've done Croatia, I just got back from the Maldives, and where else? I did Indonesia and Bali.
Wow. Yeah. When you say you got friends in those locations, are these people you meet online and like...
Yeah, it'll be people we meet online, you know, so the type of content I create, there are a lot of people creating similar content around the world and we just kind
follow
of
each
find
other and yeah.
Like
find each other. Yeah, it's a little community and it's cool because, you know, there's guys, and I've met a lot of them this year and we've seen each other's content, we follow each other, we chat online and now, I go to the States and I link up with friends there, I go to Europe and I link up with friends there.
Yeah.
And it's just this, the internet's made the world so much smaller, you know.
Do you guys share each other's concepts or you need to come up with your own?
A bit of both. So, you know, one of my friends, he might be good at this one part in editing and I might be good at something else. So we'll trade secrets and help each other out with certain shots and whatnot. So,
Right.
Yeah, it's all about collaboration. Yeah.
Well, while people are probably wondering, what kind of stuff does he film? Well, here's one example. This is you snowboarding in Austria, right? What was this like for you?
Oh, this was unbelievable. So with snowboarding, you have this thing called powder, and that's when you get
that's
a whole dump of snow. And that's just the ultimate thing in snowboarding, and I'd never experienced that before when I arrived here in Austria.
So that's like really fresh
really
snow.
Really fresh snow. I mean, you can
do
a belly flop into it, and you're never going to hurt yourself. It's really soft.
Right.
And I'd never experienced that before, and when I arrived in Austria, everything was green and brown. There was hardly any snow, and 2 days later, it just dumped. And we just got the most amazing
snow. How thick was it?
Oh, a good 3-4 feet of fresh snow.
Right. Yeah. And it's best when it's fresh, eh?
Best when it's fresh. When it's icy, I mean...
Yeah, it starts to turn to sludge.
2-3 weeks later, after this clip, I ended up snapping my collarbone in half from falling on a hard, compacted ice.
Why do extremists do this? Why? Yeah. Why do you do this?
All right, so here is Chris snowboarding in Austria.
Thank you.
incredible,
so
man.
So Insta-worthy.
Yeah. Mm. But you like to dress. You don't like to wear...
For a picture, I would. Just in the snow.
Do it for the gram.
For life,
just for the
gram, exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
The stuff you film, where does it go? Does it go purely online, or are there shows or films?
That... No, it all goes up online, so on my Instagram page and my YouTube channel. That's what I've really been focusing on this year.
And how do you content. So you're traveling 6 months out of the year, right?
Pretty much.
How are you funding these trips? How are you funding this whole exercise?
It's a combination. You know, you'll work with certain brands, and they'll help fund and give you a budget to make this happen.
Like an athlete.
Exactly, like similar to an athlete. A lot of sort of... What I've found this year is licensing footage is a great way to fund projects. So when I was in Bali, that was a self-funded trip.
Right, but you get so much tape.
Yeah, so much tape
you can sell it to the next James Bond film.
Yeah, a record label from Europe contacted me, and they're like, hey, we want you to make a music video. Do you have any footage? I was like, well, I've got all this footage from Bali that's on my YouTube channel. You can see it. And they were like, well, if you can put a little storyline together, let's make it happen. And you just license footage, and then you have unbranded content on your YouTube channel, which is just
amazing. You can sell it to Right, exactly. Wow. Nice. That's great. Yeah, nice. You see? Now, you've also gone to Namibia, right? Yeah. I know that people here in Cape Town... Well, have you gone sand surfing or surfing in the water in Namibia?
Surfing in the water. I've done sandboarding there as well.
Sandboarding, yeah, right.
In Namibia.
Yeah. Namibia's an amazing place. Really? So it's really cool.
You can do it here in certain parts of Cape Town, but I don't know if the experience is still the same. Like Betty's Bay.
Yeah, you can do it, but I mean, when you go to Namibia and you're in the biggest sand dunes in the world, it's really quite something. You know?
Yeah.
No, it's unbelievable.
All right, so we've also got a clip of you surfing in Namibia. We'll talk about it, but first, let's take a look. Have you ever been to Namibia?
Yes, I have.
I've never been.
Oh, you need to go. You need to go.
If you just want to get away from everything, you go there because
it's so peaceful and easy.
Yeah, very easy.
So what were you doing there? You were chasing a wave or?
Yeah, so I mean, this wave is super famous in the surfing community, and it only breaks, you know, a maximum of 6 to maybe 10 times a year. So a surfing buddy of mine, he called me up literally a couple of hours before we left, and he was like, hey dude, this wave's going off, you know, there's an epic opportunity for you to film. And so I couldn't surf at the time, I was injured. And, you know, a couple hours later, we packed up my car and 5 of us jumped in and we drove 24 hours nonstop all the way to this wave in Namibia. And guys from all around the world had flown in from California, Hawaii, Peru, Brazil, just to surf this wave for, I kid you not, about two days. And
What's so special about this wave?
How perfect it is and how long it is. So if you see at the end of this clip, I filmed a guy with my drone, and he surfs the wave for 1 minute, and he's in the barrel, which is the ultimate thing in surf. He's in the barrel for probably 80% of the wave. And I mean, some of the surfers get emotional about this. They come out and they start crying because they can't really comprehend what's just happened, you know? And it's uncrowded, it's in the middle of nowhere, and it literally is the most perfect wave on Earth.
Huh. They come out crying.
I kid you not. A friend of mine, he came to me and he was like, he just couldn't really comprehend what had happened. He was like shedding a little tear, and he was like, you know, what else is there to do now? You know, he couldn't really believe it.
Wow. All right. There's a whole bunch of stuff that people can check out on your,
my YouTube channel.
YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Of you doing these amazing things. We've got one more of you wakeboarding in the Philippines.
It's my mate Dylan.
Oh, you?
Yeah, okay. I was there with him.
Are you still snapped collarbone?
No. Oh, okay. I was good. I rode a bit. There was another video that we made from the Philippines that I had a little bit of riding in, but I went with my buddy Dylan. He's one of the top riders, and we wanted to make a really nice edit of him riding
doing
in the Philippines.
Yeah. All right, let's take a look.
Very interesting. While we were watching that, you were telling us that, giving us a little tourist tip on going to Bali.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're saying that we shouldn't go. Oh, we should. What should we do?
I say when you go to Bali, go there for a few days, but then island hop. I say like Bali's very touristy nowadays. It's still beautiful. Mm. It's still amazing places to go, but definitely island hop if you want to experience more culture and more untouched tourist spots. You know, more secluded beaches and whatnot. Yeah. So yeah.
You travel so much now. Does any of it get old or not as exhilarating?
Not yet. I mean, this is my first year out of university, so I've just been traveling as much as I can.
Ah, okay.
It's still quite new to me.
New beginnings,
If I kept going back to a certain place, it would probably get a bit old, but I mean, I'm going to keep doing this until I get bored of it, I guess.
Nice.
Right. Okay, so where to next?
No real set plans. I think I might be going back to the Philippines in January and hopefully back to Europe in February, but I'd also really like to go to the Bahamas and Japan. Yeah. There's a lot of places I really want to go to.
Right.
So, yeah, we'll see.
Your shots obviously romanticize all these places. Not every place can be beautiful and amazing, right? Like, you must have had some bad experiences.
Yeah, it's my job to make it look super amazing, you know? Yeah. I'm not going to deny that, but I mean, okay, Namibia really is that amazing.
No, it is amazing. Right.
Yeah. No, some of those places really are that amazing.
Bali's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, no, I don't want to say they're not beautiful. They really are, but I guess it just depends where you want to go.
Where will you not go back?
Where will I not go back? I'm not in a rush to go to Bali because I've been there twice now.
Okay. All right, cool, gotcha.
Yeah. But I mean, nothing's going to stop me. I say that now, I'll probably be back there again next year. You know.
All right, Chris. Well, thank you for coming to share those stories and these videos with us. Chris Rogers, everybody. You can follow him on YouTube and see all the other stuff that he's been up to and, of course, his future endeavors as well. Right now, we're going to take a short break, hashtag the weekend edition, and we're going to be in the kitchen soon. We'll be right back.
Making pizza.
It's a weekend, yeah. It's a weekend, yeah.
All right, guys, we're having a pizza morning. You can have a pizza afternoon or even a pizza night. Ilse is showing us how to make homemade pizzas. It's real easy. You don't have to buy them ready-made. You can actually make them at home, make them for a party, make them for the kids.
Yeah?
So, all right, so we made the dough, and what are we doing now? I see some crazy ingredients. I see eggs, asparagus, peaches.
Peaches,
I feel like those might be nectarines.
Well, nectarines. All right, nectarines, yeah.
Nectarines. Do you want to taste
apologize.
Those? I would love some. I'm really hungry. Thank you.
And that is not mozzarella.
No, this is ricotta.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, what kind of pizza are we making?
So I was thinking, because we're going into summer, let's play a little bit with a fruity pizza.
Okay, cool.
And what people don't realize is it's not only pineapple that can go on pizza. So you can add, like, nectarines, you can add cherries, you can add strawberries, berries, whatever.
So we're all going to make a pizza?
Yes, we're going to make one.
Yeah.
Okay.
I feel like you look like you want to make a pizza.
Definitely.
Yeah?
Is this going to be a competition? Okay, I think I should roll one out of it. Well, I do the toppings for the one. Someone else can roll the other one, no?
Should we do an assembly line, or what do you want to do?
Yeah, I'm going to do two bases, and I'm going to show you, because what I'm going to show you is a breakfast pizza.
Oh, yeah, right. I used to love pizza for breakfast. Me and my brother used to fight, because we'd have pizza on a Friday night.
Yeah,
and then the leftovers. And then we would fight to have
it's
a cold
the best
pizza.
The next morning.
Yeah. I don't know why. But...
So, and I mean, we all know bacon and egg pizzas as your breakfast pizza, but I'm going to show you something a little bit different. It's one of my favorite things in the mornings.
Yeah.
Asparagus and poached eggs.
Oh.
It's the match made in heaven with hollandaise sauce.
Mm-hmm. Amazing.
So, you'll see that it's a rough, like a little rustic pizza, okay? We're not going round and classic, round and perfect.
Yeah.
You want it to look a little bit rustic.
Mocha, you're in New York, so the pizzas are still around there, right?
Yes, they are, and they're cheap.
And they're big.
And what is it, a dollar a slice?
A dollar a slice.
Who wants to roll this
but
one
But they're quite thick as well, aren't they?
Yes.
They're not nice and thin, like...
Depending on how you want it.
Can I get a volunteer?
Let him roll it out. You want to come on down?
Come on down.
Okay, so there's your flour and your pizza. You can roll that one out for me. And then I'll show you this one in the meantime. Okay, so I think let's start...
All your pizzas are the same shape. Is that on purpose or is that just what just happened?
That's her signature.
It just happened, you know.
Oh, okay.
And also we need to get it off the counter here, which I see there's not enough flour, but anyway. I'll make that work.
You okay.
Know?
No, you're doing great. You're doing
so
great.
Let's just pretend like we're going to do the breakfast pizza here.
Right.
Okay, so the breakfast pizza, like we discussed earlier, you can literally put the base in with a bit of oil and pre-bake it and then add your toppings.
Right.
So what we're going to do here is we're going to take our cream cheese okay. for the breakfast pizza and you add some cream cheese to the base. And, I mean, you don't necessarily have to always stick with the tomato option. You can even add, like, a bechamel sauce to your base, depending on what your toppings are. So it
why is the tomato
really
topping so popular? Is there a reason yummy. Why, or...?
It's true Italian, no?
Yeah. Yeah. It tastes good,
too. Yeah, it's really good. It's good. So, basically, I've put some cream cheese on here, and that's going to go in the oven as is.
Okay.
Okay, so let me get this lifted so you can get this off the counter here. Do you have enough flour there? Well
probably
done.
Not.
That's a good job.
You can see that you are pretty professional.
Yeah, I know he's in the pizza kitchen.
That looks a bit too
okay, if you can pass me the tray, please. I can just get this on the tray.
All right.
A little flour. I'm covered in flour.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if it's imperfect or anything like that, right?
No, not at all. Remember also, I mean, it's gonna bake and it's gonna... Ooh, look at this. You can even stretch it a bit.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't make pizza boxes around, so why should we make pizza?
All right, and then what about his? Does his go in as well?
So now we're going to do the next one.
Okay. Should I put this in the oven?
Yeah, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm going to grab a cloth for my hands here. So that looks beautiful.
Stoked.
I know. I'm really professional.
I couldn't have done that any better.
Years of experience.
Fantastic. Okay, so we're going to bring this over here. Okay. Now, this one's a bit different. All the toppings are going... Straight
on top.
On.
Okay.
Whoa. For this one, I'm going to add mozzarella. This is the fruit pizza.
Should we not put it in the baking tray first? No.
If you want to.
No, I'm just worried about the, you know.
He's like,
the chef is here to show us. He's like, I think we should do it this way.
I think we should switch sides.
Right.
Okay.
What cheese is that?
So we're skipping,
this is the mozzarella cheese.
We're skipping the tomato here. We're just going straight
to
the mozzarella.
There's no tomato, just mozzarella cheese.
Okay.
Because this is the fruit pizza.
Right.
The thing with fruit pizza is it's nice to add some savory elements to the pizza. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't want all sweet. You want to balance the pizza. So I've got my mozzarella here. Then next up, we're going to add the prosciutto, which is here. So... Normally, this would go onto the pizza after it's been baked, but I quite like that it goes crunchy in the oven, so you've got that extra texture on your pizza. So we'll put this on the pizza.
Can I have a little slice? I'm hungry.
Oh, of course.
Just a little tiny, while we wait. Just a little, yeah.
Excuse my hand.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Yes,
you can have that. So the nice thing about this is your peach is quite, like, sweet. Mm-hmm. And then you've got the saltiness of the prosciutto and the crunchiness once it's been in the oven. Mm-hmm. Look how nice and rustic this is. The kids will love
this. It looks like it'll go well with
some
wine. I'm already thinking of some Chardonnay or something.
Yeah. Now we're going to add a little bit of the ricotta. Just like drop some drabs here and there.
And ricotta's cheese, right?
Yes, that's right.
So we have mozzarella and ricotta.
Yeah. The ricotta is going to add that extra little bit of creaminess to the pizza.
Is it salty? Yeah.
It's not that salty. That's why I added the prosciutto. Uh-huh. So it's got that extra salty element, okay? You can be quite generous if you want.
Mm-hmm.
You
know? Mm-hmm.
Go. Okay. Next up.
Okay.
My hands are beautiful.
Peaches. Oh, not peaches. Nectarines. Sorry.
So next up, we're doing the nectarines. Okay. You can do bigger slices or thinner slices, all depending. What some people also do, and it looks really beautiful and rustic, is if you heat up griddle pan and you just like sear the peach in there, you've got the beautiful griddle marks on the on the pizza.
Right.
So we're adding our.
So we're going to bake them as well.
Yeah, we're going to bake the peaches.
Okay.
Because what's going to happen is it's going to start caramelizing the sugars in the fruit. So it's going to be even more sweeter and nicer on the pizza. Okay. So we've got that there.
Yeah, it looks dope.
Look how gorgeous, eh?
Yeah.
It is looking good.
And you know, if you want to play around, another combination that's really fantastic is also cherries.
I was about to say some sort of jelly as well.
Cherries with your cheese, and then you add like fresh rocket at the end with some balsamic drizzle or some balsamic glaze.
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's also a good one. Okay, I think we've got everything on here to go into the oven.
Okay, and then we'll so that goes in the oven, and then you're going to do the glaze afterwards.
I'm going to do that afterwards, and the fresh herbs.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so this one is the breakfast pizza after we've put the cream cheese on and it's baked. Mm-hmm. So as you can see, beautiful little rustic pizza here.
Now, how do you cut that for a family?
I was about to say,
do you just rip it apart?
Because we're going to have whole toppings on here, I would rather get a little pizza wheel and just do your slices.
Like you'd want to be even.
Yeah, I mean, you can do little squares, you can do, depending on what you want to do here. Mm. So this pizza is our breakfast pizza, okay?
So it's got eggs on it already?
I'm going to put some eggs on right now.
All right, yes.
So on this one, we're adding some asparagus. I absolutely adore asparagus. You can chop it, you can put it on whole. I quite like that it's rustic when it goes on whole.
Thank you. Asparagus is hard to chew. Do you cut it up? You just put it on there as
you can cut it up. This one isn't cut. It's a little bit more rustic.
You have like a vegetable allergy.
Not allergy. It's just asparagus. It's hard to chew. See, look, Khanyi's trying to be like...
She's like, the faces you're making.
Do they show?
Yeah.
Okay, let me put my game face on.
You are a carnivore.
So, the asparagus is blanched. It's you can see it's still nice and crispy. You've got an extra texture on the pizza. Okay,
Why not?
Poached eggs.
Poached eggs. And the nice thing with this is you can pre-poach your eggs and just reheat it before you put it on. Which is really great. Look how beautiful these
are. Are we still
going to
put this in the oven or no?
No, this is finished.
Right.
So this is like our topping.
So you could have grilled the asparagus as well if you wanted to or done something.
You could, yeah. I mean, definitely, yeah. Okay, so. And then we're going to add a very, my favorite thing on what we have here.
What is this?
It's hollandaise sauce.
Oh. Yeah.
And look how gorgeous that is on the eggs.
Benedict.
Yes.
Like a fancy eggs Benedict.
Yeah, that's really great.
So you've got the savory of the cream cheese at the bottom. You've got your hollandaise. And it's one of my latest favorite combinations is chives and fresh thyme. Mm. And both of these are a perfect match for your pizza. The chives and thyme go really well with your hollandaise and eggs and your asparagus. So we'll just strip. Do you want to strip some of that off the leaves for me while I chop this?
Sure.
So you're definitely eating this with a knife and fork.
Oh, you have to.
No?
Yes.
Yeah, I would say. Or like if you have a slice with your own egg, you can let the egg, the yolk, do whatever it wants to do.
Make sure you're wearing a bib, right?
Yeah. But who doesn't like to eat messy?
Yeah, exactly.
What do chives taste like? Can you try chive?
Good.
Just on its own. Let's try.
And there goes the chives.
Chives smell great.
Look how beautiful that is.
That looks amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's
good.
Very colorful.
Not on its own.
I don't think we're going to see such a green-looking
pizza. It does feel like quite a healthy-looking pizza. Mm.
Yeah.
Would you eat that after a day of surfing? Or a night of surfing?
I'd probably eat three or four.
Right.
You'd get really hungry.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you can even add prosciutto on this one as well, if you want.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's all so much made in heaven. So beautiful. Thank you for your help. Appreciate it.
And those are our final two products, right?
This is the final product. That's not yet. Okay.
Oh, right. We're still going to add
that. That one is done. That's our breakfast pizza. Okay. But now we're going to finish off this pizza, which is just going into the oven that I just passed on to you.
Yeah, it's still in the oven, right? So this is a ready-made one.
Okay. So now we're going to finish this off. A fantastic, fantastic pairing for nectarines is basil. She got that pepperiness of the basil. I'm just going to add some of the basil leaves here.
How do you come up with these combinations? You just think them up or just experiment or find them somewhere?
It is experiment. Yeah, thank goodness for Pinterest.
Thank God for Pinterest, yeah.
There are just certain ingredients that pair. It's been established in the food industry. Mm. And then other things you discover, you know?
What kind of toppings would you go for? If you had a pizza base, what would come to mind with you?
Oh man, I usually enjoy avo, bacon,
banana.
What else? I haven't actually tried that.
Oh, have you tried banana?
Avo, bacon, is the and best. Banana.
Is it? It's a very specific taste, I think, banana for people on pizza. Yeah, because it's warm banana. I mean, I'm not really the biggest fan. So on this pizza, we've added some fresh basil. And what I'm adding here, it's a reduction that I've made with honey and balsamic vinegar. So you use about a cup of balsamic vinegar with a quarter cup of honey and just slowly cook it down by half. And then you have that beautiful honey flavor to your balsamic glaze. So we're just gonna do that little bit of a glaze over here.
How pretty that looks.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Looks crazy.
And there's your...
It's very Instagrammable.
As you know, we're about that Instagram life.
We are.
The bloggers
Instagram life. So that will be your summer fruit pizza. That will be your breakfast pizza.
Wow. Look at how it transformed, right? From when it was without the basil and that fancy sauce that we all need the recipe to.
And we made the dough here.
But I think we should eat it now, if you'd allow us to.
Well, let's do it.
Oh, yes. All right.
Okay. Which one do you want to try first?
While they get into that, we're going to take a short break. The recipes, once again, on our Facebook page, The Weekend on 3. Otherwise, we'll hashtag The Weekend Edition all across social media. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. All right, guys, welcome back. We're sitting here with two beautiful, lovely ladies, Simphiwe Dana, and of course, you know, and Makho. You guys met before. I had no idea. Mm-hmm. We actually have proof of this. Video
Tell
evidence
she told
of
you
this.
That you're ashy. She knows you.
Simphiwe keeps it so real.
She's always ashy.
Oh, see the shade. But I love her. Huh? I love her so much.
So, it's because she's so pretty, I'm jealous.
You're both pretty.
No, I love Simphiwe. I saw her on Instagram and I knew she had to be my friend. So I stalked her.
Oh, and then is that how you got that interview?
Pretty much, yeah.
Oh, and then I invited her to Ethiopia.
Yes. We had a fabulous time.
When I was doing the, what you call? I was a convener of the AU's Arts and Culture chapter.
Wow.
I spent like 8 days in Ethiopia with you. Simphiwe is so much fun.
I'm not. Did I tell my
Simphiwe?
I'm a serious musician, thank you.
She's a serious musician. But
does she turn up?
She will turn up.
I do not.
She's a responsible turn-upper. She's not like drag out loud on the floor.
No, I'm private.
She's
put
very
it like
private.
That.
No,
I'm private.
No, of course.
I hang out
get
with
that.
My friends. We have lots of fun away from the medding crowds.
I'd like to come to Ethiopia too, then.
Right? A trip to Addis.
Yeah, I mean.
Ooh. When are we doing that again?
I don't know. Hey, we should do it soon.
Well, here's a video
anniversary
of the interview that you got of Simphiwe after you stalked her that led to your crazy trip to Ethiopia.
Yeah. Welcome to New York. How are you feeling, like, being here? Like, how does it feel to be sitting in New York City today?
You know, I love the pace of New York. You know, if you see us, I speak very slowly.
Yes.
I think once I'm going to just live here for a few months and I'll be speaking so fast.
Yeah.
I'm going to be on the go every day, on the go.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I love the city.
Yeah, New Yorkers are very fast-paced. We walk fast, we talk fast, we eat fast.
Yes,
we're very, very fast.
Yeah, I like it.
So I like to do a little thing in my interviews where we do some icebreakers, right? Where I ask you a couple of questions, like the last thing that you did, and all you have to do is just respond to me, like the last thing that you did, just very fast, very off the brain, off the cusp.
Okay. What if I'm secretive?
No, well, you can just say pass. I'll give you a pass, only for one question.
Okay,
so what was the last reality show that you watched?
Oh my God, the one with the twins.
Tia and Tamir?
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. The last compliment that you received?
It had to do with my music. It was today.
Today? What did they say?
My music saves their lives every day.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's deep.
I know.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Welcome.
Simphiwe is cringing looking at herself. What do you not like about that video?
No, I'm so slow. I'm such a slow talker.
But
I think I've improved now a little.
But why would you want to speed up? You just.
Do you?
She
was like on the go.
I'm a New Yorker. I'm an African New Yorker. I speak fast.
I'm a Joburger. They're also fast.
But the good thing is, even though
you're an Eastern Caper.
Okay, I'm a girl from the village.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Now that we've got that, I don't know.
Even when you tour, it's slow.
She may speak slow, but what comes out is very impactful.
Yeah.
I love hearing Simphiwe speak and sing.
Thank you, Makho.
Yeah. So what was that like for you to meet her?
To meet her, as you can tell in the video, I'm fangirling out. Yeah. I am a genuine fan of amazing women, as I said before, and she's an amazing songstress. So just being in the room with her, and actually, it was one of my very first interviews. So I didn't go to school for journalism.
Right.
I just kind of picked it up by watching people like you guys.
Right.
So I'm grateful to people like Simphiwe for
giving this random girl from Zimbabwe a chance.
Yeah.
She could have easily said, no, I'm a big star. Why would I talk to this girl?
Yeah.
But she's opened up her heart to me. She's taken me to Ethiopia.
Because of your sweetheart.
And you need, yeah, so now you can stop calling me Ashley. No, can I stop?
Good.
I want to know more about this Ashley story.
It's deeper than deep.
Yeah, it's clearly very deep. But we'll delve into that in just a moment. So you're doing something, are you doing something with a symphony?
Yes.
Tell us about that. What's happening?
Okay, so it's been a few years in the making. It's finally happening this year. I'm recording a live DVD with a 60-piece orchestra, a 40-piece choir, and a dance ensemble. And I'm featuring two of my most favorite artists in the world.
In the world?
Yes. Two, okay, I've got many favorite artists, right?
Wow.
But these two, they really
are you telling people who they are?
Okay, yeah, can you?
It's Buika from Spain. And Asha from Nigeria.
Wow. Oh, Asha, yeah, I know Asha. She's incredible,
but you mentioned
right?
This years ago, and you still kept on building to this because you did speak about this in
Well,
passing.
It will be the biggest thing that I've ever done by myself.
Yes.
You know, just thinking about it, it gives me like
goosebumps.
Have you ever done that Symphony Rocks show that tours South Africa? I think they do it every year, every so often.
No,
that's quite an epic production to have a symphony, and then you've got your regular musicians, and you've got the performance component of it as well.
With like a choir. It's going to be so awesome.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh.
It's so beautiful.
How do you, how do you rehearse for that? You kind of have to piece it all together. You won't hear it until...
No, I have to hear it. I'm going to be like hobnobbing from here to them. I must go to the choir, check that they have all their lines, they know their harmony.
But you're not going to hear it all together until on the day, even yourself, right?
Until like 2 days before when we all get together, 3 days before when we all get together. But, you know, I'll be moving from, you know, to the musicians, to the orchestra, to the choir, to the backing vocalists, to the
and the dance
dancers.
Piece.
That's crazy that she's doing this.
Yes, a dance piece.
I thought you would have someone
in the car right over here this morning.
Right.
I'm sleeping because it's 6 a.m. But Simphiwe is on the phone talking to whoever. I was kind of eavesdropping on your conversation because that's what we do when we blog. But she was talking to the dancers, the manager, and she's putting...
And
she's
she was putting lotion on your elbows at the same time, right?
No, she just told me I was ashy. She didn't put the actual lotion on.
Oh, come on, you gotta take care.
She's a businesswoman as well. Like, there's the business side of the music. Like, she's an amazing singer, and she... belts out these vocals, but she's also about that business.
But what type of dance is it?
Well, it's going to be more contemporary. I actually did a show with the same dancers about 2 weeks ago.
Somebody's going to call you right now.
Yeah, I hang up the phone now.
Yeah.
And it's like...
So, with Gregory McComa and his dance company called Fiani Dance Company, we did a few of the pieces that we will also do for my show. But that one was like a three-way collaboration. Fiani and his dance company, myself, and Volta Kellerman. So I'll be basically using the same dancers, maybe twice as many of them. And it's contemporary. It's like you'll see Pansula there, you'll see Kayenzo there, you will see, you know, ballet. Like you'll see all different expressions of dance.
Wow. And how many people are going to be at the show?
On stage?
Yeah, no, on the audience that you're trying to attract.
So it's on the 26th of November at Theatre on the Tracks, which is in Kailang.
Gotcha,
it takes about 1,200 people. It's a very intimate.
Yeah, very intimate for such a big production.
Well, I'll be there. I'll be one of those.
Yeah, I mean, it's important when you're recording live, you know, to have as much intimacy as possible, you know, acoustics, you know, like the room, to have a... nice sound, like the technical side of it. I could have taken it to a bigger
Do we have good theaters in this country? Because I feel like other cities around the world have the most incredible venues from that technical perspective, like acoustics.
That's very true. We could do with quite a revamp in South Africa. But I mean, we still need to just up our game when it comes to sound itself. You know, sound and technology in the country, we're still lagging behind a little.
Really? I thought we'd close the gap. Okay.
Nope.
All right. Well, she studied IT, so she would know. What type of IT did you study? Was it like her husband's IT, like software engineering? Her husband's a software engineer.
She knows IT.
Yes, I did coding. I did
all of that
boring stuff.
I did coding too.
I did
engineering, electronic engineering. So
yeah, actually, my first job offer was to code. Mm. I was still doing my last year.
Yeah.
And I turned it down.
Who gave you the offer? Can you tell us?
It's called NTA Software Services.
Oh, okay, right. Wow.
That's what they're called.
And you turned it down.
I turned it down because I really hated programming.
You have to sit there by yourself.
I mean, I'm a loader, but
be happy
I'm not
with your little
bad.
Algorithms and be.
Listen, you actually make one tiny mistake in
the whole thing is over,
whole thing falls apart and you have to go through line.
But that's why you save your little plug-and-play solutions.
It always happens that you don't.
All right. Well, it's absolutely a pleasure to have both of you ladies here, and it's actually, what a coincidence that you guys actually knew each other.
Yeah.
So
I didn't
earlier,
know that she was coming. Like,
right,
she just jumped in the car, and I'm
she's like, what?
You were like, man, this journalism has gotten out of hand. Get out of the car. All right? Well, we saw you guys doing that interview earlier on, and now we get to see you performing as well.
Yes. I'm so tired. I hope this is going to work out. I'm nervous.
It will work.
It always does. It always does.
Here's Simphiwe Dana.
Wow. The next song we're doing for you is called Mayine. And this song I wrote for Busim Hlongo because I wished upon her lots and lots of blessings because she had blessed us with so much beautiful music. And I felt the world was not giving to her in return what she was putting into the world. Mayine. No.
umbrella. Diggy, 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 diggy. No man send lele. I as a peli. Dilele nas vinye.
She did a good job. Hashtag the weekend edition. Stick around because we're going to check out a business called a Takkie Wash. I don't know what that is, but hang around because I'd like to know too. See you after the break. It's a weekend.
Welcome back to the weekend edition. We've got the whole squad here in the dining room, ready to feast, right?
Yeah.
Guys, go ahead. You guys want to dig in and we can chat?
Corner slice?
Why not?
We've got Makho Ndlovu. We got my man Greg Rogers. Is it Greg Rogers? Chris Rogers. You know what it is? I'm thinking of Buck Rogers once again. hold on, all right. And Theodora. So listen, Makho, I wanted to ask you, what's your take? You came down here for the mamas,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
And you're a blogger.
I am.
You spread gossip, as we do sometimes.
Good news, yes.
Good news. Yeah. What's your take? Why do you think Trevor Noah did not show up?
So I have a theory. I really don't think Trevor Noah was sick. And Trevor Noah, I love you, but I don't think that he was sick.
Right.
I think the U.S. elections at that point were 13 days away. And there was no way that Trevor Noah, at the epicenter of hosting The Daily Show, could leave. And host the mamas and give it the time and attention that it deserves. So I think he kind of pulled out last minute. And I think that was sort of the reason why. And I believe that Viacom knew that people were so interested in seeing Trevor do this big show and come back home, and the excitement was there, that it kind of would have, you know, killed the buzz of the show. But shout out to the ladies. Wanang, Yemi, and Nomzamo stepped in and stepped out. They were fantastic.
Wow, okay. Nice. And obviously, as a result of that night and that week, a lot of things happened. You obviously had Casper attempt to fill up Orlando, right?
Yes.
We can't say he filled it up.
No, he didn't fill it up, but there were bodies.
It's like 80%, right?
It was warm. The temperature was warm. Yeah, it was warm.
It was a lovely show.
And then after that, him and AKA hugged it up. They actually had a hug
around the world.
Yes.
Right. What was your take on that? We're talking rap, by the way.
Yeah. Well, you guys know AKA.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I've filmed with
AKA before.
Oh, have you? That's cool.
I used to dabble in the festival scene.
Oh, really?
No. I'd say that's probably what got my name out of it. There was shooting festivals.
Yeah, we used to actually go to festivals together.
Theo and I met at a music festival about 4 years ago.
Are you guys dating?
No.
Oh, okay. I thought.
Yeah, there were some Google eyes.
Yeah.
It's kind of like you and some people.
Funny fact, the one guy who used to tutor me at university is Theo's boyfriend.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
world.
Small world.
That's and you guys now sort of do the same sort of thing.
Yeah, on that YouTube game, you know.
Yeah.
We make very different type of content, but it's, I mean, I still
same
know
village.
Knows me.
And we also started at the same time as well, so we've always kept in touch. Yeah,
that's cool.
Okay. What? Awesome. You don't feature cups in your... Oh, sorry, that's...
Okay,
all right,
that was,
yeah, all right, sorry. Wow, okay.
back to the rap.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
what
was the attendance of the dome?
He says he wanted 40,000 tickets. Apparently 30,000 showed up, but I think the venue, the way it was set up, actually holds 90,000.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, it does.
So there was some...
But 30,000
there was some
still,
rigging,
it's
some voter fraud going on.
I mean, for me, 30,000 during one night is a lot.
It's a lot. It's a lot. And as a local act, I think it was remarkable what he did, and I applaud him. Because
well, he's going to if and be next now.
Yes.
So.
Well, yes. Do it, Casper.
Very interesting. How's the pizza, by the way, guys?
It's really good.
Really good.
Yeah?
Nice. Really good.
All right.
Well, Joe, sometimes you need to leave the city to try and find really good things. Brett and the Weekend Edition crew hit the road and went to Mkalele, 60K south of Johannesburg, to see true Gussie style in action. Let's check it out.
Weekenders, we're on a road trip. We're off to Everton to meet a group of truly inspirational young people who, when they couldn't find a job, created one for themselves. They created the Takkie Wash, which not only does tackies, but carpets, bags, and whatever else you need done. Let's go check them out. The Takkie Wash began earlier this year by three men who not only wanted to do something different, but also wanted to earn an income to provide for their families. From a dusty street corner, the sound of brushes scrubbing away heralds this innovative business.
Hi, hey, how you doing, man?
Hola, hola, put. Bunjani, put.
I got very dirty shoes, man.
I can make them new, my friend.
You think so?
Yeah, I can make them new.
All right. And what about these? All right, how much is that?
It's 30 rand, too.
Perfect. Thanks, man.
Thank you.
60 rand for two pairs of shoes to be cleaned. I have a lot of faith in these guys. Let's see how it goes.
This growing enterprise has proven to be a hit, and the team wash an average of 15 pairs of shoes on weekdays, with 20 or more pairs of shoes coming in on a Saturday, along with other goods to be cleaned.
You guys started with tackies, and now you do carpets. Do you plan on doing anything else?
Yeah, since I don't get the ningu, I wash my blanket, I wash my toilets, I wash my kulpeke, na makepisi, I wash.
Why did you choose this corner to start your business?
To clean off the dust and dirt, the guys have their own secret soap formulation and methodology for taking worn-out sneakers from downright dirty, pristine and refreshed.
I see you put paper on the shoes. What is that for?
It's a toilet paper to protect it from dust, and it can take the stain out.
You guys have a secret ingredient. I'm sure you can't tell me what it is, but do you have any advice for our viewers back home?
I into abanga yenza abantu abawalethe so awashe. Abawalethe so awashe. Bazobona silenza libe mhlophe. Sparkling white.
Support for the fledgling business was hard to come by in the beginning, but friends like Marlani Soterian offered encouragement and his skills as a photographer to document their journey.
I've been with Takkie Wash since it has begun. I've been behind the scenes, frankly. I've been the photographer, taking the pictures from the first pic they took.
So those photographs that I saw on Facebook, those were your photographs?
Yes, that's my work.
All right, good work.
The photographs proved instrumental in promoting the business online, and they also have a huge social media following.
The goals are to see it grow much further, you know, expand, have branches all over, and be able to provide services for a lot of people.
It's not just the guys' great work that's helped the business grow. The only woman on the team, Basiswa, is the brains behind their social media success and handles marketing.
I had an assignment at Skolweni whereby I had to promote a business that doesn't have a website because I'm doing a webmaster. So I came to them, promoter their business. Then they agreed, then I become part of Takkie Wash. At the moment, Askaga been a sponsor. So sometimes you guys feel like as Senaman or Kubek and a business, but with Utemba on my side, he always motivates us.
This is hard graft, and their dedication and determination has won the community over.
I come to the Takkie Wash because it's very affordable and I'm very lazy to wash my own takkies. I bring my sneakers. The guys do a really good job.
I come to the Takkie Wash because these guys make the takkies very spick and span, eh?
Tommy, do you get your takkies washed here?
They always wash my handbags. I'm not a takkie person.
This is how Kazi Commerce works. A will, a way, and some very hard work. And perhaps a little bit of help. So if any of you out there can donate a desk, a sink, or some paint, or anything else that can help them expand, please get in touch with the Weekend Edition. Peace.
Wow, what a phenomenal business.
So you can take your takkies there and they'll wash them for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, no more stinky.
My son's shoes, yeah. My son in particular.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we're gonna take a short break. We'll be right back. Hashtag the Weekend Edition. It's a weekend, yeah.
Weekend, yeah. All right, we're back in the kitchen with Ilse. We're making another pizza because today's pizza day.
Yes.
And you can actually make a dessert pizza. I did not know this.
Yes.
Is it, if you put sweet stuff on a pizza dough, is it still technically pizza?
Yes, of course.
It's a sweetza. Once it's got sweeter, it's a sweetza.
I like that.
I mean, if you think about pizza, it's a kind of bread, basically. You know, I mean.
Okay.
What happened to the days of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, you know?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, but that was a sandwich.
Oh, it's still a sweet.
Yeah, you're right.
It's not in my house, depending on kind of day it is.
So we already have the really prepared base here. So okay. It's been rolled out, a nice coating of cream cheese, mm-hmm. and some berry compote that's been made. For those of you who don't know, berry compote is fresh berries. You can use frozen berries. Just make sure that they thaw in the beginning. And then you add quite a bit of sugar and you boil that until it becomes syrupy, add a little bit of lemon juice and some butter to make it even better.
I just want to know how you eat all of this and maintain that weight. Because if I even smell this, I'm gaining 10 pounds. So
how?
How?
It's a constant struggle. I'm not going to lie. okay, so then you have your base. You bake this with your berry compote and your cream cheese.
Just before you continue, okay, this is heated. Yes. What do we want to do?
This is going to be for the white chocolate ganache.
All right, so should I leave it or?
You can take it off.
Take it off, yeah. Okay, cool. All right. Okay.
So the cream is boiling now.
Yeah.
Okay, so for the white chocolate ganache, we're just going to boil the cream. And you're going to pour it over the chocolate.
Mm. All right.
You're going to let it melt and mix through.
Okay. Okay.
Would you suggest cooking chocolate or just regular white chocolate?
Regular white chocolate works fine.
Okay.
Yeah. I prefer regular chocolate.
Yeah, I'd say.
All right.
So this base is ready and we're just going to dress it now. Lots of fresh berries. You can do a mixture of berries. You can do strawberries, raspberries. I would add blueberries. Today we have raspberries, so let's work with this. And you add that beautiful, like, tartiness of the berry now. Because it's quite sweet what you have on the base at the moment with a cream cheese that's a bit savory.
Yeah.
Which is fantastic. I always like to, I know it's a dessert pizza, but I always like to add a little bit of something savory. And that's why the cream cheese works so nicely with this.
Okay.
Okay. So we can take this now. Thank you.
I've still got the heat going. Oh, we don't need it.
No, we just pour it over the chocolate. Let it melt. Because that's the thing with chocolate. You're not supposed to be messing with it too much. Just let this melt and sit there and do its thing.
Mm.
Okay. So we've got our berries on here. And then what I did was I made some honeycomb. So,
you
I mean.
You made this.
Yes. Wow. It's the easiest thing in the world. Really? People don't realize how easy it is. Are you okay there?
No, I'm just, you know, trying to turn it off.
Okay.
So you make, wow.
Yeah, so you all know how to make sugar syrup.
Yes.
So this is just your sugar and we add some maple syrup to it.
Okay.
I prefer to stir it in the beginning so it starts dissolving a little bit. Otherwise, you're going to start
struggling. Like, can I taste a piece?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to show you a little trick here.
Oh,
so
hard.
To get this, you give it a nice bash. So just give it a nice, cracking.
It smells so good.
Yeah, you guys can help yourself, right?
Yes. Oh, it smells
good. Smells like a kid's party.
And I promise you, once you realize how easy this is to make, you're gonna make it all the time. And I easily finish a batch for myself. I know it's embarrassing,
it
but I
chocolate,
do.
Chocolate, it must be incredible.
Yeah, so good. And also what you're doing here is you're adding such nice texture to your pizza.
Right.
Smells so good.
Or even chocolate ice cream. Oh, man.
I mean, you can do so much more here, but now we're gonna add some of the honeycomb. How's my ganache doing? Is it melting?
Do you need a spoon in there or something?
Yeah, do you want to stir it?
Yeah, let me.
Okay, great. So we're adding some honeycomb here. It's one of my favorite combinations is cream cheese, honeycomb, and berries. Mm-hmm. So delicious together.
With these combos.
Yeah, I feel like you need to write a book of combinations, like the best combinations.
You know, there is a book actually, I think, who's got all the combinations that you can buy. Yeah, it's really good.
No, I know I
it's
said
almost like, it's almost like the Bible of flavors.
Yeah. Mm. Mm. I know I said the previous pizza was Instagrammable, but.
But this.
My photo? Everybody, yes. My photo. Okay,
okay. And see, now you have the colors here, the beautiful golden honeycomb, the bright red berries, that darker cooked version of the berry. Okay, so I'm going to be quite generous.
Yes.
Pass my ganache.
There's like one lump I'm trying to get rid of.
Okay, good. Okay. So then, next up, we're doing the ganache. There's so much you can do with dessert pizzas.
All
I
right,
mean,
there
so
we
much.
Go. I think.
Good. I mean, if you're hosting
the. Else.
Look at that. Oof.
It looks a bit decadent.
Okay. Mm.
Yes.
Right? Mm. Like
imagine
you can only have like a little square like this big.
Imagine like going to a restaurant and seeing pizza on the dessert menu. Mm. That would be so interesting. Maybe someone should do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, definitely. And you know what the nice thing with this is? If you if you're entertaining kids, you can do like sweets, like proper packets of sweets to make it look interesting for kids. So it's so much fun to do this for kids. And then just to finish it off.
Oh my goodness, when
a little bit of
that is much more, yes.
Little bit over.
Oh, I was attacking the previous
maple
pizza,
syrup.
But this guy stands no chance.
So just that added touch of maple syrup to make this pizza even more delectable.
Wow.
And this is legal.
Yes, it is.
Well, it's a moment on the lips, you know what I'm saying?
Adult
and there
candy.
You go. Wow. There's our dessert pizza.
Wow. 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 Well, guys, once while we try and eat that, Brett met up with an amazing stylist called Khanyi, also known as a sangoma, to try and figure out how her fashion and being a sangoma come together. Hashtag the weekend edition and show me your style. What are you wearing this weekend? Give me ideas. What can I rock this Saturday after the show? See you after this.
In the continuing search for great street style, the Generator in Parkmore is the next destination, and the style expert on hand is an intriguing, dynamic, and creative individual named Khanyi Makwakwa.
Khanyi, thank you for joining me over here. It's very exciting to have you here. Can you tell me a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Okay, I'm a stylist, a strategist, and a sangoma. Generally, I like to consider myself a storyteller because whatever I'm doing, every aspect of my work relates to storytelling. As a stylist, I'm telling the story, the visual elements of story through film, editorial work, and even for an individual's personal appearance. Although I don't generally work with individuals. I prefer to work on productions and bigger stories and be a part of telling the story in that sense. And as a strategist, again, it's trying to understand what story a brand is trying to tell and how to interpret that. And as a sangoma, it also comes down to interpreting the story that your ancestors are trying to tell you, that the universe is trying to communicate to you when somebody comes to me with a conundrum in their life, kind of untangling that and helping them understand where they fit in and how they fix that. It's a matter of storytelling in a sense, because if they don't understand it and there's no context for them, there's no way that they can take their part of the story forward.
So it's the weekend and we're not meant to be being so deep, we're meant to be light and fluffy. So, fashion. Tell us about what you're wearing today, like what's the story?
Okay, I'm wearing an oversized vintage, like, I don't know if it's a shirt, a mini dress or what. But it's something I picked up in the vintage streets, and I just liked it when I first saw it. I think I got it about a year ago. Then I'm wearing a kosinkosi knitwear,
nice.
Pencil skirt with the Ndebele prints. I really love Ndebele prints, just in general. I've always have. And I'm wearing my Alexander McQueen sneakers.
Are you wearing Alexander McQueen sneakers?
Has a lot of. Yeah, it's just a lot of blue and lots of pops of color.
All right, enough talking. Let's go find some pretty people. I'm sure there's some out there.
Let's.
Khanyi is passionate about the upliftment of African women, and she expresses this in her styling work and also her fashion label. So it's no surprise she quickly eyes out some stylish ladies. So the generator in Park Mall has delivered beautiful young women. Obviously she has brains and talent, but her fashion is incredible. Who are you?
Hi, I'm Nell.
Tell me about how you get dressed in the morning.
Well, it's all about how I wake up. It depends on my mood. I don't have any specific style. I just dress whatever I want to dress, however I want to dress. Yeah.
Amazing. And Khanyi, what do you think? Tell us what you think of beautiful men.
I mean, where do I start? I think she's gorgeous, firstly. I love the hair color, lips. It's just like there's so much life in what she's wearing. The green, the red that we're seeing. Absolutely love it. What like inspired your hair color?
Well, I just decided to go wild. I mean, it's spring, so we have to showcase everything we've got as, you know, women.
All right, so sometimes the coolest things are understated and gentle and not so shouty and in your face, like, you know, Khanyi. And we found Rita. Rita, tell us about your outfit.
This is kind of my style, so I like things that are easy so that I don't have to think so much in the mornings. So I pretty much go for blouses and flat shoes, and the pants are also just different colors and different styles. So this is pretty much my work style.
We found amazing Cabello over here. She's a part of a troupe of three gorgeous, stylish, amazing women, and you're gonna see all of them just now. But right now we're focusing on this incredibly beautiful woman. Cabello, tell us about your style.
My style is all about respecting my body. I'm young, gifted and black. So right now I'm thick, so I have to look beautiful. So now I covered my look with a nice floral top and nice high waist skinny jeans and some nice shoes. Summer, you must wear wedges.
I love this. I love the whole look. I love the body. I love how you've, you know, like wrapped yourself. And it's just, we saw you and we were just like, that girl, you know?
That's all we got for you this weekend on Weekend Wear. Don't forget to send us your favorite outfits from the weekend at hashtag the weekend edition. And also let Khanyi and I know what you think about our style.
Who would have thought that Khanyi, a full Sangoma, would know so much style and have so much taste, right? Hashtag the weekend edition, show me what you're wearing so I could steal your style, probably cop it after the show. Who knows? But stick around because we're going to have this Phat and Simphiwe Dana performs yet once again. See you after the break. It's a weekend. Welcome back. We're still standing in the kitchen, but before we do anything, I'd like to give you a recap of all our recipes on our pizza day. So remember that you can get all these recipes on Facebook. It is that simple. It's the weekend edition on Facebook. Check it out, try it out, and let me know what you think. Here's the recap.
Our theme in the kitchen today is pizza night. For the dough, leave to rest, divide the dough into balls and make pizzas. For the breakfast pizza, cover the dough with a thick layer of cream cheese and bake until crispy. Top with generous amounts of toppings and drizzle with hollandaise sauce, then sprinkle with fresh thyme and chives. For the summer fruit pizza, add mozzarella, layer with prosciutto and top with small scoops of ricotta. Top pizza with peaches and bake. To finish, add fresh basil leaves, ground black pepper and a drizzle of balsamic honey reduction. For the dessert pizza, top dough with cream cheese and berry compote and bake until crispy. Top with berries, chunks of honeycomb, and drizzle maple syrup and white chocolate ganache. For the full recipes, visit the Weekend Edition Facebook page.
All right, the guys are trying to fight over the pizza. Guys, be nice, be nice. No need for war. That's a humongous piece.
Wow, he always gets the biggest pieces.
All right, while we enjoy the pizza, guys, Simphiwe stuns us with another absolutely stellar performance. Take a look and enjoy.
Okay, the last song we are doing for you is called Malaika. This song is from Tanzania. And Malaika means my angel. Now, the history behind this song is that there was a guy who loved a girl, but he could not afford to pay for the lobola. And therefore, he wrote her this song. And I hope the guy got the girl, because it's such a beautiful song. And I think it's more than 100 years old now. Malika.
Show, guys, thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget, we're on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. The recipes are on our Facebook page, and we're all over social media, hashtag The Weekend Edition. Until tomorrow, ta-ta.
Bye.